for the advancement of Aboriginal women. Let's welcome her.
Hey, what a beautiful day. What a beautiful day with everyone out who's here to maintain the strength that began many years ago to identify and to cut through the indifference of this society to the deaths of our women. I'm proud to be here. In 2005, I was asked to go to Renew Hall to accept the honor of the Order of Canada. The reason they gave that to me was because of the work we had done on the murdered and missing Aboriginal women. And it's been a long, long trip. It's been a long, long journey. It's been a long, long struggle. So we declared, we didn't ask anybody, we declared the decade of difference. We declared the decade of difference from 2005 to 2015 because of the indifference. Many, many, many women, Indigenous women, Aboriginal women, went before the government officials to make it known that our women were dying and no one was being charged and no one was being held to account. So it's been a long, long struggle, but it's going to work. We now have the inquiry coming to this province into the deaths of murdered and missing Aboriginal women, and it's, as I said, very, very important that this be done with good faith and tell the truth, to tell the truth of what has happened in this country. You know, many people say, oh, Canada is a beautiful country and very compassionate and caring. And it is for some people, but not for all people, and not for our women. We know that the 1,200 that the RCMP listed as murdered and missing is not the true number. It is not the true number at all. There are thousands, and they've been mistaken in thinking that the women of this country, the Indigenous women, would forget this. We will not forget. And I wanted to share with you a saying by Rose Yellowfeet, an elder from the South. She said, Aboriginal women have mountains to climb. Rest if you must, but never give up. And I don't see any indication that anybody's giving up. If you can show up on a rainy day like this with all the passion and determination that I can see in your heart, I believe that we will win. And we will be able to talk to the government, because now we have the best government in the world, right here in this province. And I'm proud to say that I have struggled again, ran five times for the NDP, didn't get in, but everybody who worked there was really caring, and I'm proud to say that. I'm a Métis, born 65 miles east of Edmonton in Vermont, and I grew up in Whitford, Alberta. So I'm wanting at this point in time to acknowledge the land of the Treaty 6, that this is their land and the homeland of the Métis people in this province. So I thank you so much for that. And listen, we're going to win. I'm convinced that the province of Alberta and the Dominion of Canada will never be the same after this inquiry. And we're building on such beautiful blocks. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission has done a marvelous job. The Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People all over the world are going to change the world to be truly that Canada can say it is caring and compassionate to the Indigenous women in this province and in this country. So we need everyone to work together. We need to support each other. We especially have to be caring for the little children. And I know you share these views, and I know that we will be there no matter what happens. We will be there to see that justice is done. And you know that in this province, the Cindy Glidew case has not been, the Court of Appeal has not come back with its answer, and we're waiting for that. And the judge that talked about the arrogance of the judge who said that this girl should have kept her knees together. That's reprehensible. We have to fight it at every turn. We have to be strong, and we need the men of our country to support us. Thank you.
I know we speak about the government, but we also need to help ourselves in our own communities. We owe it to our victims to take care of their families, their children, and their grandchildren. What I see, we don't see, is the PTSD, the trauma, and the mental illness that comes with murdered and missing families. Those footsteps leave ways, and I deal with youth whose mothers are murdered and their souls are lost. Men need to protect us women, but if you have a son whose godmother was murdered, we have taken the skill of protector away from him as a child, as a protector, and he could be lost. And I'm making any mistake, but I just know that we need to love and take care of this generation. And all sides need to come together. Our communities are not safe. When our women are raped and beaten from somebody on the community or in their home, in their, I hate to say the word reserve, but in their community, and then they have to try to go to the police to arrest them, and they try to get charges, but that woman has to go back to her community and look at the man who did this to her. So we need to make the chiefs and our communities to stand up and protect our women better. We need to push for policy change when it comes to dealing with mental illness for our brothers and sisters. And I mention brothers because it's not about just young women. We have our males missing too. And we have to love our two-spirit and our transgender. This generation is free for change. And we need to stand by them. I stand here today honoring my family that has been murdered and has been missing. And it's cold. I think that's all I want to say. I just know that as a survivor of 35 years on the street, I am only now walking my red road. I used to be ashamed to be First Nation. But I tell you today, as a 50-year-old First Nation woman, I'm proud to stand here with the rest of my brothers and sisters and raise awareness. Because this is not a protest, it's an awareness. And thank you, and my boss wants to say one thing. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Juanita.